The next day, the great crowd that had come for the festival heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, as it is written, "Do not be afraid, daughter Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt."
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to evening prayer here at St. Peter's. And we encourage you to join in with this. I hope that you find this act of worship helpful on this Palm Sunday. Let's pray. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. Let your ways be known upon earth, your saving power among the nations. That this evening may be holy, good, and peaceful, let us pray with one heart and mind. Blessed are you, Lord God of our salvation. To you be praise and glory forever. As a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, your only Son was lifted up that he might draw the whole world to himself. May we walk this day in the way of the cross and always be ready to share its weight, declaring your love for all the world. Blessed be God Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God for ever. As our evening prayer rises before you, O God, so may your mercy come down upon us to cleanse our hearts and set us free to sing your praise now and for ever. Amen. And we come to bring to before God our sins and the things that we have done wrong, that we might receive forgiveness through Jesus Christ. When the Lord comes, he will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Therefore, in the light of Christ, let us confess our sins. We say together, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, forgive us our sins and make us holy to serve him in the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We read Psalm 62 together. I wait patiently for God to save me. I depend on him alone.
He alone protects and saves me. He is my defender, and I shall never be defeated.
How much longer will all of you attack someone who is no stronger than a broken down fence?
You only want to bring him down from his place of honour. You take pleasure in lies. You speak words of blessing, but in your heart you curse him.
I depend on God alone. I put my hope in him.
He alone protects and saves me. He is my defender, and I shall never be defeated.
My salvation and honour depend on God. He is my strong protector. He is my shelter.
Trust in God at all times, my people. Tell him all your troubles, for he is our refuge.
Human beings are all like a puff of breath. Great and small alike are worthless. Put them on the scales and they weigh nothing. They are lighter than a mere breath.
Don't put your trust in violence. Don't hope to gain anything by robbery. Even if your riches increase, don't depend on them.
More than once I have heard God say that power belongs to him and that his love is constant.
You yourself, O Lord, reward everyone according to their needs.
O God, teach us to seek security, not in money or theft, not in human ambition or malice, not in our own ability or power, but in you, the only God, our rock and our salvation. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is taken from Zechariah chapter 9, verses 9 to 12. Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will free your prisoners from the waterless pit. Return to your fortress, you prisoners of hope. Even now I announce that I will restore twice as much to you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The New Testament reading is from Mark chapter 11, reading verses 1 to 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage and Bethany on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, Go to the village ahead of you, And just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you doing this, say, the Lord needs it, and will send it back here shortly. They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, what are you doing, untying that colt? They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches that they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed behind shouted, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
If you've been to the Holy Land, you'll know that the journey from Jericho to Jerusalem is an uphill journey. Jericho is probably the lowest city in the world, 800 feet below sea level, whereas Jerusalem is 3,000 feet above sea level and not so far away. And if you travel that road, you're going quite steeply uphill most of the time. And the road brings you to the crest of the Mount of Olives, where eventually you are able to look across the valley to the Temple Mount. And this was a route well known to the pilgrims who would go up to Jerusalem several times a year for the major Jewish festivals. In the reading that we've heard from Mark's Gospel, it's Passover time, one of those major festivals. And the Gospels suggest that these events happened on the 10th day of the Jewish month Nisan, the month in which the Passover takes place. And we also need to remember that Jewish days begin in the evening, just before sunset. So it's the evening time, and the 10th day of the month Nisan is just beginning. If we look at the original account of the Passover in the book of Exodus in the Old Testament, we're told that on the 10th day of Nisan, the children of Israel were commanded to bring the Passover lambs into their homes and to look after them for several days until the 14th day of Nisan, when they were sacrificed or slaughtered. And Jesus comes to Jerusalem on the day when that happens. And in another part of Jerusalem, it's very likely that the Passover lambs that would be slaughtered in the temple were being driven in. It's thought that the Sheep Gate in Jerusalem gets its name for that very reason, that at this moment, the religious Jews were beginning to bring in the lambs that would be slaughtered a few days later. Now, all of that is the background to what happens in this story, which we know as the account of Palm Sunday. On the day when the Passover lambs are being brought into Jerusalem in readiness for this annual Passover event, the one who is actually the true Passover lamb, Jesus himself, also arrives at Jerusalem and enters in. Jesus is also very well versed in the Old Testament prophets. And as he begins this journey from the Mount of Olives into Jerusalem itself, he actually arranges to fulfill a prophecy of one of these Old Testament prophet Zechariah, who tells us that in the future there would be a humble king who comes riding on a donkey. And as Jesus gets on that donkey and begins the last part of the journey to the city of Jerusalem, the disciples start to honour him as king. And they do things that you wouldn't do for anyone but a king, like putting their cloaks on the road, waving palm branches. And for those first disciples, this was in many ways the moment they had been waiting for. They believed that Jesus, who they had left everything to follow, would become the King of Israel, that he was the promised Messiah. And so they began to do this in the expectation that in the hours that followed, he would indeed be crowned king, and their expectations would be met. But actually what happens is that it all ends in a massive anticlimax. We're told at the end of the passage that Jesus went into the temple, he looked round, but as it was already late, he took his disciples and went out for the night to the village of Bethany. He doesn't stay very long at the temple. And that leads me to ask the question, what were those disciples thinking when that moment came at the very end of that day? Were they disappointed? I think they probably were. Puzzled? Very much. Perplexed? Yes. Everything seemed up to that point to be going to plan the way they thought it would do. But then it all suddenly fizzles out. It's not there anymore, although they're still there with Jesus. And perhaps it's at this point where we start to find ourselves in this story, where our present experience overlaps a bit with the experience of the first disciples. I wonder whether you have ever asked yourself the question at some point in your life, what does God think he's doing at this moment? This isn't turning out the way that we expected. Has God somehow lost the plot? And in this story, we learn that God hasn't lost control at all, and that Jesus is all the time fully aware of what these days hold for him, because the law and the prophets are being fulfilled. The disciples, of course, haven't quite grasped it. And we know that because there are several occasions in the Gospels where Jesus spells out what's going to happen when they get to Jerusalem, but they don't quite understand what he's meaning or what he's talking about. Now, I think we can say that God doesn't expect us to understand everything that is going on around us, in the same way that he didn't expect his first disciples to understand everything that was going on the first Palm Sunday. But God does want to reassure us that he is with us and that we can trust him when everything around us seems to be very untrustworthy and not turning out the way that perhaps we expected it to. From today, Palm Sunday, the church's year encourages us to live, as it were, in real time, the events that the New Testament describes. We go through Holy Week to Easter Sunday, and then beyond that into the Easter season and 40 days after the resurrection to Ascension Day, and then 10 more days to Pentecost. We can relive in a small way the journey that the first disciples went on, and it was quite a roller coaster in many ways. And as we relive these events and try to walk in the shoes of those disciples who were perhaps in a very similar place to ourselves, perhaps we'll be able to hear God speaking to us afresh through some of these events, God speaking very clearly to us about what he is doing and what he wants us to do, and particularly about the challenge to trust him through times like these. Let's pray. Lord our God, your word says that you answer and deliver people when they call on your name. So we ask that you would heal and protect those who are sick or who are carrying the COVID-19 virus without knowing it. We pray that you will provide a cure for the coronavirus, heal our economy, and bring a quick end to this darkness. Whether healing comes today, next week, or next month, we believe you will heal our world, and we will continue to praise you even as we wait for answers. We pray all these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
So we come now to our time of intercession. Let's pray to God and bring before him our concerns for others, for the world, and for ourselves. With confidence and trust, let us pray to the Father. For the mission of the Church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, let us pray to the Father. Lord, we pray for the health and well-being of everyone at this time, for those who are isolated, housebound, and lonely, for families spending long periods at home together, trying to keep children happy and entertained, for all those who are taking care of neighbours, friends, family, or volunteering in any way, for all those continuing to work in courageous service to their communities at this time, especially those in health and social care, those working for delivery services and supplying food, and those keeping other vital infrastructure services going. Lord, protect, guard, and care for anyone who is vulnerable in any way. Lord of compassion, in your mercy, hear us. For peace in the world, that a spirit of respect and reconciliation may grow among nations and peoples, let us pray to the Father. We pray for those who are guiding our nation and the nations of the world at this time. May those who are shaping national policies make wise decisions and give us grace and strength to support them in our prayers and to follow their leadership in our actions. Lord of compassion, in your mercy, hear us. For the poor, the persecuted, for refugees, prisoners, and all in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, let us pray to the Father. We pray for those who are not able to stay at home at this time because they have no home, and for all who are working to protect, shelter, and feed them in these difficult days. We bring to God anyone who has lost their job or been put on furlough and reduced income because of the current crisis. We pray for families struggling to feed children without the support of school meals. Lord, for all who are fearful and anxious and in any kind of need or distress, may they know your peace, the peace that passes our understanding. Lord of compassion, in your mercy, hear us. For grace to amend our lives and to further the reign of God, let us pray to the Father. In a moment of quiet, we call to mind any whom we have injured or offended and ask God's forgiveness. Lord, we ask for your blessing on our local communities, that our neighbourhoods may be places of trust and friendship, where all are known and cared for. Lord of compassion, in your mercy, hear us. In communion with all those who have walked in the way of holiness, let us pray to the Father. In a moment of quiet now, we call to mind any who are known to us who are suffering at this time, in body, mind or spirit, with any sort of illness, or who are grieving the loss of someone they loved. And we ask God to draw close to them tonight. Lord Jesus Christ, you taught us to love our neighbour and to care for those in need, as if we were caring for you. In this time of anxiety, give us strength to comfort the fearful, to tend the sick, and to assure the isolated of our love and your love. For your name's sake. Amen. Lord of compassion, in your mercy, hear us. We commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And the Collect, the special prayer for today, Palm Sunday. Almighty and everlasting God, who in your tender love towards the human race sent your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, to take upon himself our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, grant that we may follow the example of his patience and humility, and also be partakers of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and for ever. Amen. And standing at the foot of the cross, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen. Now to the gate of my Jerusalem, the seething holy city of my heart, the Saviour comes. But will I welcome him? Oh, crowds of easy feelings make a start. They raise their hands, get caught up in the singing, and think the battle won. Too soon, they'll find the challenge, the reversal he is bringing, changes their tone. I know what lies behind the surface flourish that so quickly fades. Self-interest and fearful guardedness. The hardness of the heart, its barricades, and at the core, the dreadful emptiness of a perverted temple. Jesus, come. Break my resistance and make me your home.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but and pour contempt on all my pride. forbid it, Lord, that I should boast, save in the death of Christ my God. All the vain things that charm me most, I sacrifice them to his blood. See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did as such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown? Were the whole realm of nature mine, that were an offering far too small, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul.